Dear students, in this small session, I will discuss with you about the transmission and pathogenesis of mycoplasma. In the last session, we discussed about the features of mycoplasma, the cellular features, the structural features of this mycoplasma, the taxonomic position, then about the different species which are which infect humans of this mycoplasma, then about infections caused by mycoplasma. Two infections were discussed, pneumonia and reproductive infections. So now in this session we will discuss about the transmission and pathogenesis of mycoplasma. So in the last session itself I discussed about how these mycoplasmas enter into the host organism. It will evade the immune system once it enters into the host body. So about the transmission, it is transmitted from an infected person to another person through aerosols or through contact. That's how it is infected, it is transmitted, that is through mainly through aerosols or through contact. In the last session we discussed two infections, and one of that is the pneumonia caused by mycoplasma pneumoniae. There the organism is transmitted through aerosols, and other one mycoplasma, another one we discussed which is causing reproductive infections, that is transmitted through contact. Mycoplasma genitalium is transmitted through contact. So once inside the body, what they do, they enter the cells by attaching to the surface of the membrane of the host cell. Okay, preferably they are attaching to the columnar epithelial cell. So they attach to the surface of the membrane of the host cell, and what happens now, the host cell will form a phagosome. Okay, this is internalized and a phagosome is formed, and phagosome along with the bacteria is then internalized completely by the normal cellular process. So phagosome formation is a normal process of the cell. So this bacteria, this mycoplasma, will induce the cell to internalize this bacteria. Phagosome formation is normally occurring in the cells. Through that process, this bacteria will enter into the host cell. So first is it will attach, and once attached the cell will internalize this organism by forming a phagosome. Now normally what the cell do is, we studied about lysosomes. We studied about in the previous semesters about phagolysosomes, how phagolysosomes are formed, then how digestion is taking place inside the lysosome, how it is forming residual bodies, all those things. That is the process which is happening here. Phagosome is formed, and next process is it will be forming phagolysosome. But here phagolysosome will not form. That is the main feature of evading mechanism of this bacteria. So once inside, they resist the formation of phagolysosome complexes and thus escape the digestion of the cell's phagocytic mechanism. Actually, once something is internalized through phagosome, it is digested with the help of lysosome, and residual bodies are formed, and it is the whatever waste is or whatever is formed inside the lysosome after digestion is sent outside the cell through exocytosis. But here this process is not happening. Only the formation of this phagosome is occurring here, and it will remain safely inside that phagosome. It will not form phagolysosome. It will safely remain inside the phagosome and starts its reproduction. So in the cytoplasm they divide, so they are safely in the phagosome. Now they start divide by binary fission and are released mostly by budding. They divide by binary fission and they are released outside by budding and sometimes by bursting of the infected cell. This inside the cell they divide by binary fission, and large number of these bacteria are formed inside the cell, and they go outside this host cell by budding. Sometimes when large number of these cells are formed by binary fission inside the cell, the host cell will burst and release the cells outside. And so being intracellular, they are living inside the host cell, okay. So being they are obligatory intracellular parasites like viruses. So they are having so many features common to that of viruses, and they are having features common to bacteria, and they are actually considered as bacteria. These mycoplasmas, being intracellular, they are not easily detected and removed by the human immune system. Immune system cannot detect them there because they are inside the cell. They are growing inside the host cell. So they cannot detect. Also the host cell, the cell's digestive mechanism cannot digest them also, because phagolysosome is not forming. So they are not easily removed from the body. So since they are able to resist the formation of phagolysosome complex, they avoid destruction by lactic activity inside the cell. And since they do not have cell wall and enzymatic pathways for cell wall synthesis, the ordinary antibiotics cannot act against them. Ordinary antibiotics actually work by inhibiting the cell wall synthesis of bacteria. So those bacteria which are having cell walls, they cannot synthesize their cell walls and they die. But here there is no cell wall. So these antibiotics cannot be used against this mycoplasmas. So what happens? This will result in long-term chronic infections in the human body. But these infections are not immediately fatal. Certain infections caused by mycoplasma, they are removed by the body after some time, or they disappear from the body after some time. But many will stay there, multiply in the body and form long-term infections. And they are not immediately fatal, but they induce several secondary reactions. So that's all about the transmission and pathogenesis of mycoplasma. Thank you.